Can you picture a world where you have no say in your government? Before the American Revolution, this was the life of every citizen of the colonies. The mother country, England, used the colonies simply as a source of income. England's royalty reaped the benefits of the colonies without giving them any representation. As James Otis, a lawyer and patriot, said, "Taxation without representation is tyranny." Hostilities between the colonies and England grew. The reason for this heavy taxation was that England was in debt from the French and Indian War. This spurred the American Revolutionary War to start in 1775 and lasted until 1783. A year after the war started, America still hadn't separated completely from Britain, scared that without the trade, their nation would crumble. Articles like Common Sense, written by Thomas Paine, helped Congress decide to commission Thomas Jefferson to write the Declaration of Independence, the document sent to England that made their political divorce official.
Now, on July 12, 1776, just after they had declared independence, the Continental Congress also was trying to create some kind of a proposal for a new national government. And between 1776 and 1777, the Continental Congress drafted the Articles of Confederation. And the Articles are the document that literally created the United States of America. They literally gave that name to the United States of America. But it's important that to note that they actually meant that really literally. I mean, we sort of don't think of what that phrase means, but it was meant really literally in the context of what I'm talking about now. What that said was, this was not one consolidated nation. This was United States, what the Articles created. It united some states together. That's what that phrase literally meant. As John Adams explained later, they never thought of consolidating this vast continent under one national government, but instead erected a confederacy of states, each of which must have a separate government. So when 13 free and independent states had defeated England and now had to figure out how to come together, they were not thinking of one big unified republic at this point. They really definitely were not. And that's the Articles of Confederation went along with that thinking. It did not create one unified government. It did not bond people together in anything other than a loose league. The Articles created a loose league of individual republican governments.
The Articles had many problems. There was no court system, no power to enforce treaties or laws, and there was no power to raise an army. The tax system was so unstable that many farmers were being taxed more than they could make and lost their land to the state. It was especially bad in Massachusetts. The fact that the state refused to forgive the unfair taxes was the cause of Shays' Rebellion, a group of farmers who led a series of protests, turned violent against the government, and sent the powerful message that a change needed to be made. This led to the Federalists taking a stand for a new form of government, the battle for the new American Constitution. It was evident that the Articles were not strong enough to keep our country organized and united. This much was obvious by the Shays' Rebellion. However, not everyone saw it that way. There were two main sides, the Anti-Federalists versus the Federalists. The Federalists were the people for the new United States Constitution. They were focused on trade, and they wanted a form of centralized government. The most well-recognized Federalists were Alexander Hamilton with 51 Federalist Papers, James Madison with 29, and John Jay with 5. The Anti-Federalists were the people against the new United States Constitution. They were scared that it'd become an overarching tyrannical government like England was, and they wanted the states to stay sovereign. The most well-recognized Anti-Federalists were Patrick Henry, a vocal anti-Constitution protester, George Mason, a non-signer of the Constitution, and Samuel Adams, an anti-Constitution speaker. The arguments. The judiciary decides the meaning of laws, how to apply them, and if something is constitutional or not. Under the Articles, the states could litigate freely. The problem with this was that there was no court system to address laws that impacted multiple states, and there was no way to keep basic laws the same from state to state. The Federalist solution was the court system. This system gives the judiciary one set of laws and has a Supreme Court to make decisions in cases that affect all of the states. However, still Alexander Hamilton said, "The judicial branch may truly be said to have neither force nor will, but merely judgment, and must ultimately depend upon the aid of the executive arm even for the efficacy of its judgments." This was true until the case of Madison versus Marbury in 1803, a case in which the Supreme Court gave itself the power of judicial review, a system that gives the Supreme Court the power to overrule another branch to avoid tyranny. An amendment is when a document is changed or added to. Under the Articles of Confederation, as in the Continental Congress, a unanimous vote was required for an amendment to be passed. This means that it was nearly impossible to amend the Articles. Therefore, our nation was caught in a never-ending cycle. The Federalist solution was to grant the power to amend with 2/3 Senate and 3/4 of the state votes in favor. Alexander Hamilton said, "Whatever fine declarations may be inserted in any constitution respecting it must altogether depend on public opinion and on the general spirit of the people and of the government. The military is the defense against opposing nations." Under the Articles, the Congress had no power to draft a militia and the states were not allowed to create an army. The states did not have to provide men to back any wars that Congress started. Under the new Constitution, Congress has the power to draft and maintain a military. James Madison said, "America united with a handful of troops or without a single soldier exhibits a more forbidding posture to foreign ambition than America disunited with 100,000 veterans ready for combat." Currency is the money used in a particular country. Under the Articles, the Congress as well as the states were free to coin money at will. This system caused mass inflation and made money worth a differing value in different states, and made some states put high taxes, called tariffs, on goods from other states. This satire, named The Looking Glass for 1787, shows Amos Doolittle's Federalist views on military pension and paper money, and shows a wagon representing Connecticut laden with debts and stuck in the mud, and the factions of the government trying to pull it in different directions. The Federalist system gave only Congress the power to coin money. This keeps the economy even across the states. The Constitution was ratified in 1788. Many of the anti-Federalists, George Mason, a Virginia delegate in particular, still stood against the Constitution after 9 states agreed to its ratification because of its lack of protection for the individual people. James Madison remedied this by writing the Bill of Rights, a collection of 10 amendments that gave people rights, such as freedom of speech, the right to bear arms, along with many more. The Bill of Rights was approved by the Senate in 1789 and ratified by the states in 1791. Under this new Constitution, we have a justice system that keeps the laws the same across the country and works well and is efficient. We have a system to pass amendments that will work in favor of the majority and keep up with our fast-changing nation. We have a military that will provide America with troops in times of war, and a currency system that helps keep inflation down and stops state tariffs. The Constitution is a document written by a group of men who saw a problem that couldn't be solved by amendments to a crumbling government and wrote a new one. The Federalists recognized the failed government that the Articles created. They realized that it took away the voices of the Congress, the states, and the people. They took a stand for a government that would keep their new country strong. The Federalists succeeded in making a thorough case and being an integral part of the ratification of a great living document that makes our country stronger to this day. Yes, my countrymen, I am clearly of the opinion that it is in your interest to adopt the Constitution. I am convinced that this is the safest course for your liberty, your dignity, and your happiness. Alexander Hamilton.